Our gracious Father, we thank you. We magnify your holy name because of what you have started in our midst. We bless you because you are a mighty God. You are the God that is omnipotent. There is nothing that you cannot destroy because you are a man of war. And your name is Lord. Father, I pray your children have come before you, not before any man, not before any woman, but before you, our Creator and our God. Whatever might be that issue concerning every soul here today, Lord, I pray that your power will come upon those issues and destroy them in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The rod of the evil shall not be put on the righteous, so that the righteous will not put their heart into sin. I pray every rod of the wicked against any soul here be destroyed by the fire of Holy Ghost in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord God Almighty, your word is coming out. Your word like two-edged sword. Let it perform those miracles and wonders you have sent it to have done today in our lives in Jesus'
Amen.
Name. And at the end of today's meeting, Lord, only your gracious and mighty name shall be glorified in this sanctuary in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, our Lord.
Thank you, Father.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Don't let's be seated yet, please. Nearer, my God, today. Nearer today. Psalm 73, 1-28. Are we there? So truly God is good to Israel, even to such as have a clean heart. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped, for I was envious of the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no bounds in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. Therefore, pride compasseth them about as a chain. Foulness covereth them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. They are corrupt and speak wickedly. Concerning oppression, they speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore, his people return hither, and waters of a full cup are wrung out to death. And they say, how doth God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I shall offend against the generation of the children. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then understood I thy hand. Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. Thou castest them down into destruction. How are they brought into desolation? As in a moment they are utterly consumed with terrors. As a dream, when one awakes, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise thy image. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee. Nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holding me by my right hand. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. Whoever hath in heaven but thee, and there is none upon earth that I desire but thee, beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a warning from thee. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all the words. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Shall we be seated? God bless you. Destiny of the wicked. That is the title of today's message. God asked me to tell you the hand of the wicked. Destiny of the wicked. I don't know if it has ever happened to you, that have you ever stopped believing? It can happen at any time, because life is hard and very strange. Many things are happening. You tend to be wondering, I think it's better I forget going to church. I think it's better I forget believing in God. It comes into our lives occasionally. If you live long enough, your faith is bound to be challenged many times. You will be wondering, what is happening? So this psalm, written over 3,000 years ago by Asaph, it could have been very appropriate to this time we are talking about. There is no more difference between then and what is happening now. Here is a godly man who faces what you are facing as well. Occasionally you'll be wondering, why struggling like this, and some bad people are enjoying. That is the key word. Wicked people are really enjoying, they don't have any problem. But I'm a child of God. Why am I facing this? God, are you fear? Is there fearness in this? How long will I go? You want me to go back? Who was this man, Asaph? Asaph was a worship leader, nominated by King David as well as King Solomon during the time of King Solomon as well. This man wrote 12 Psalms. He wrote in Psalm 73, and he wrote that of 73:23, and then Psalm 50. This man was a prophet of Most High God. And he was the father of Jaziel. And we know Jaziel, when those three countries came against Judah during the time of King Jehoshaphat, the Spirit of the Lord fell upon Jaziel. And he prophesied that victory would be for the children of Israel. The father of that man was this Asaph. Asaph learned 288 musicians, and when there was a dedication service of Solomon's temple, He was the one that led the service. Here is this man of God with a splendor gift of prophecy. And he came to a time in his life that he had to ask God, God, what is happening? You want me to go back? Why? Are the wicked prospering and your child suffering? We will look at the journey of this answer and look at our lives as well. I know as you are sitting down, you might be wondering, why am I going through this? Some people in the world are enjoying that, doing it in the worldly way. Why me as a child of God? I don't know if that thought is in you. But once in a while, we look at ourselves. Why am I undergoing this? Does it worth it? God, where is your face? God, are you seeing the level? And you are opening your eyes and you are looking at me. But I'm assuring you, the end of that situation in your life will be the miracle to the glory of the Lord in Jesus' name.
Amen.
It has happened to this man. Very faithful, but he got frustrated. And he started asking questions, which you and I, most of the times, occasionally we ask. And he started, first one, truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. So not only to the Israelites, anyone that is of clean heart, God is always good to them. But look at what he said about himself. Verse 2. He said, but as for me, as some of you may be thinking as well, my feet were almost gone. My steps are well, nicely. For me, I'm almost gone. And I'm not able to even stand. I'm going down. What? Verse 3. For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. When we look at some wicked people, they are happier, more content, better off. Fat bank accounts. They have many friends. They don't seem to be suffering in our own eyes because we have not asked them. They have better connections. They have more prestige. And then we look at ourselves. What is happening to me? And let me tell you, when it comes to this kind of situation, it is not only in one culture that it happens. It happens in all cultures. This situation has no boundary, no cultural difference. The people in this country are saying the same thing. The people in Africa, in Asia, in not all over the world, they are saying the same thing. That is why we have uproars in many countries. Why are you people up here? You are enjoying, we are suffering. But when it comes to Christians, am I not a child of God anymore? But I'm telling you today, that situation you are going through, if it is the power of the wicked or God, no matter the source of that situation, you will overcome that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
He was not thinking about the prosperity of the wicked. He was thinking about the sufferings of the righteous and how the wicked are just enjoying. That was a troubling question he asked. Why evildoers are raised into power and the righteous are in prison? Before we look at the reasons he gave, because this book, Psalm 73, is divided into two parts. Verses 1 to 14, questions from Asaph. Compare the wicked people with himself. From 15 to 28, the answers from God. We will look at the questions and the answers. But before we start, I will tell you a living story that I witnessed regarding this kind of situation. I've told you whatever I've experienced, I've seen, I will tell you. I was so young, about 14, 15 years old. There was a politician in our community. This man was so powerful in the eyes of the people in the community that if you take a case to the court and you come from that part of the community, the court will ask you, have you taken this your case to this man there before you come to this court? And it wasn't an appeal court. So that when we say this man has actually constituted himself as a court for others to confess before they go to the real court. That was how powerful this man was in the eyes of people in the community. This man went going out, not with only one car. There will be about 10 cars following him with all those rogues, thugs, carrying guns and everything. This man will do everything with impunity. No one can question his authority. I don't know what has happened to the government there in that country. But in that community, you need to fear this man. This man will get on the street and say, the light on that street should be turned off. He has the power to do that. And immediately you will see that the light on that street stopped. This man built a very big house. It was a court house. And they call it open fraternities for these court people. And he didn't stop at that. Years later, inside the same compound, he now built one small church. I don't know how the two coexisted. You can see this man, the way he look at life. That no one can query him in Kulidin court. We will see how Asa described him. And something happened one day. We were looking for one of our children, a small girl, about 6-8 years old. After 3 days, we found her in one of his henchmen's house, not his house, because this man has got a lot of wives. And if you're a very beautiful lady, you are passing through his house, you have become the wife. He will just call you, and your parents will come and say, thank you very much. So we find this our little child in one of his henchmen's house. After the third day, that was serious child abuse, pedophiles. We took the child. We knew the man was one of the henchmen of this powerful man in the community. So we took the child, we went to the man. We said, sir, we have been looking for this, our little child. And we found him in Mr. So-so-so's house. The next thing he said was that, you are very lucky you find where you have found your child, why are you coming to me again? Why can't you just take your child and go away? I said, God, I was so young, but I was bitter in my spirit. I said, this cannot go forever. God, something must happen. Am I this man in this community? I was so young, but very violent spiritually. I will tell you his end, but that was the end that was mentioned in the scripture. As I was so concerned, it was troubled in his heart. When we talk about wicked people, this is what I'm talking about. And let's look at verse 4. As I've said something. For there are no bounds in their death, but their strength is firm. Their bodies are healthy and strong. Before they fall sick, they take them to fasts for treatment. That is what that fast is saying. They don't have problem of getting better medical facilities. No. Fast five. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. They are not being plagued by human ills. They have servants that will look at what they eat and everything, so no sickness or such. Verses. Therefore, pride compassed them about as a chain. Violence covered them as a garment. Pride is a necklace. Who is going to ask me whatever I do? Just like one man in one office. The subordinate was asking him, Master, why are you treating me like this? You are treating me so badly. So the man said, I only put my thumb on your head. Suppose I put my whole leg on you, then what are you going to be saying? Wickedness! In the highest, every power that is oppressing you, in your school, in your working places, in your neighbor, the fire of the Lord will destroy such power in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Verse 7. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. You will see their stomach. And you will see their head big. I traveled recently and I saw one politician. The hotel where I was. Very fast. I didn't know. Saw the policeman around. I mean, guy was so, I mean, just protecting him. I noticed his stomach like this. He said, hello. I said, how are you, sir? I just said, thank you. Which police? Everything. You can see the description very, very well. Fat head, fat eyes coming out. Verse 8. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression, they speak loftily. They have callous hearts. They speak with malice. Then we think that they are Almighty God. They don't care. Whatever happens to anyone. Fast man. So they say their mouths against the heavens and their tongues walk through the earth. Hey. Then we ask you. This one is having mental problem. With your Christianity, we will deal with you. Then we will know where that your God is. Any man that has proclaimed that angel from heaven, we destroy that mouth in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because you're a child of God, you're a Christian. No any evil power, evil mouth anywhere that should be saying nonsense to you. And we have been told this morning, we are God's. With little G, small G. Just pronounce judgment on them. Because I did. For this man. Something was up. Well, you'll be looking at yourself. I'm working day and night. I'm studying day and night. Some people are not doing this. And nothing happened to them. Some people are cheating. Some people are doing 419. They call 419 cheating, gambling, or whatever. And they get away with it. They say some people in the community are untouchables. The police here, they know the criminals around. They know their houses, each one of them. Verse 10. Therefore, his people return either and waters of a full cup are wrung out to them. Their people turn to them. You see a lot of people going to them. And verse 11, very serious. And I say, how does God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? And you shut up your mouth, which Christ said, where is our God? Does God know anything? The blasphemy. Verse 12. Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Always carefree. They increase in wealth. Ungodly wealth. Well, this is not a perfect description of all the wicked people, but most of them, they have this kind of description that Asa mentioned in the Psalm. But Asa made three fundamental mistakes, which he admitted at the end of his conversation with God. The first mistake he made, which we are making as well, because when we look at these people, we also make the same mistake. We only judge by what we see. We don't need to judge by what we see. Not all wicked people get away with what they do. Otherwise, prison would have been empty. Then single some of them and lock them up. Thank God for the free democracy here. Wherever you are, you commit anything, any sin, anything against the government, eh? You violate any law, you will be in prison. Very, very, very easy. It's very easy here. But in some part of the world, who are you to imprison them? I can see the humility in one of our past ministers here, prime minister. The children got drunk. I was trying to cause trouble. And the police invited the prime minister to come to the police station for lecturing on how to rear children. And he went. Do it in some part of the world. That police is gone. You will be sacked if you are not going to be killed. What I'm saying is that we should not be judging things by what we see. The judgment is coming. The second mistake that Asaph made that we always make as well. We usually leave God out of the whole equation. We don't look at it that one day, hey, God is going to run. The judgment is coming upon them. Hebrews 11:25. That the players of sin is persistent. The pleasure of sin. Doesn't even have to suffer affliction with the people of God and to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. It's for a season. They are committing this because they enjoy doing it. The end is nothing but bitterness. That is what Isaiah 48 verse 22 says. There is no peace, said the Lord. To who? Unto the wicked. No peace. Why, I said, why are they having all the soldiers, all the police guiding them? Why do they need to get a private a security guiding them? No peace for them. That's what the book of Isaiah says. That's no peace. For the wicked, this earth is the only heaven they will ever know. For the wicked, this is the only heaven they will ever know, and it's just for a short period. The third mistake that Asaph made, which we also made, is that we forget about the life to come. It is appointed unto man once to die. After that, what will happen? Judgment. We have forgotten that. We didn't know that there will be judgment one day for these people. It was this that brought Asaph back to his senses. And there is going to be a day of judgment. His complaint was so serious, verses 13 and 14. Finally, I have cleansed my heart in faith and washed my hands in innocency. All the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. Say, God, did I keep my heart all for nothing? Why am I being holy? Why am I prophesying about your name? Why are you making me the director of the message? Said, I get nothing but trouble all day long, morning, evening. Every morning brings me pain. Now some of us too, we think like that. It was a serious complaint. But this man was totally honest with God. He was honest with God. But that doesn't mean that he was very objective, because it doesn't look the way God was. The answers are from verses 15 to 28. Verse 15. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I shall offend against the generation of their children. So there is something I can share. But even if I share this, the other people, other children of God will be wondering, why are you the only one? Why are you sharing this? He said, can we call this loose talk? Honest talk? When you're a child of God, rather than for you to go and pray and seek the face of the Lord and fast, and let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end in your life, are you going to be telling other Christians that this is what this man is saying? And if I should be saying this to other Christians, I will be offended at the generation. Not every doubt needs to be shared with everyone. There is a fine line between honesty and loose talk. Honest talking and loose talk. Some people might be wondering, no, it's easier for some people than others. Please go to them and ask them. Just like that man with only one trousers, one knicker. He wanted to commit suicide because of one knicker. He's caught. So he got to the bank of the river. And before he jumped, there was a man hiding inside the bush, nothing. He said, please, before you commit suicide, remove that knicker and throw it to me. Then you can go. If I see this one, I'll be able to go to the village to go and buy things. When the man saw him, he said, ah! So there is another person that hasn't got anything on. No more suicidal attempt again. Started thanking God. Said, I cannot tell this to other children of God, I will be offending them. There are some things we should not carelessly share with others. Then he did something very great. Verse 17. Verse 16, he was saying, when I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. But he did something. Verse 17. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood her, their head. I went to see the face of the Lord and found out God, what is going to be the destiny, the head of these wicked people. We need to go to the Lord. That's the right place, Father God. Why is this situation going on like this? Why am I undergoing this kind of stress? This politician I was talking in my village, in my community, he had so many wives, apparently, of course, there's no doubt about that. He had so many wives. Wives that he will not pay any money or whatever. Just as a lady, you are passing, just come, you are my wife as from today. Who are your parents? He just sent for the parents. Your daughter has become my wife. So he got so many wives. He got so many children. There's something happened. He got paralyzed. That was the first thing. For 7 years. He was bedridden. All the wives, what happened to them? The children? Nowhere to be found. The children were vagabonds of the highest order. You can imagine what children will come out from such wicked man. If we forget about education for any children in that kind of family. And what happened was, of course, he got some houses very close to our own house as well. And by the time all the ones deserted him, all the children scattered, those houses started crumbling. And I was watching the whole thing. I said, God, so this is how you deal with wicked people.
I was watching. And I knew it would happen. Because the wicked people cannot go there forever. No. Something must happen. The heavens must react. Otherwise, we say there is no God.
Of course, all the bodyguards, what happened to them? They left him. The man that is paralyzed, no more power. There was no any mobile phone then. And I'm talking in the 60s. To make any connection. cannot cross or even go and take the phone or the thing.
Paralyzed!
How can you have the house of Satan, court house, and you have the court to go and build a church? I don't know those people that are attending such a church. That is spiritual weakness. Wickedness and the other soul. Just playing with God, not bothered whether that is God or not. After 7 years, he became paralyzed. He died ingloriously. And I said, yes, God, this man has refused to repent. And he has gone to hell fire. No one can tell me he has gone to heaven.
Because we saw the wickedness.
Very terrible. And he refused to change. You don't know that there are some people that are repentant sinners. They have decided not to change at all.
He talked to them.
He said, no.
Change! God can still touch you. Jesus can still accept you.
No. A prayer session was going on in the church. Back home. These sinful powers, they were flying. They become bells, they become anything. And at that spot, that woman just came down. Half bed, half woman bed. It happens. If you haven't seen it, it has happened.
And the woman was talking.
And the ministers of God, they said, okay, you are sent on an error. Yeah, then she started talking about the error. She said, are you ready to give your life to Jesus Christ? She said, no. Very pure, clean, very simple answer, no. Reprobate mind.
Meant for destruction.
She said, no. And they left her like that. Asaph tried to find out the answer to these questions. He has been asking God from verse 1 to verse 14. And he came to verse 18. Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. Thou casted them down into destruction. Every power of wickedness upon your life will be destroyed suddenly in the name of Jesus.
Amen. They are sleeping ground.
They will be cast down and suddenly destroyed. They will be swept away by terror. Even when they die, the judgment will still come upon them. I think there is a case now in this country. Someone has died some years ago. And what is happening? About 50 people were saying that, oh, he abused me. The knighthood was quickly removed from the dead body that was given to him by the queen. And they are still investigating about this one.
After his death.
And the scripture is saying they will vanish from the earth. First meeting. How
are they brought into desolation as in a moment?
They are utterly consumed with terrors. As a dream, when one awakes, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise thy image. The same thing happened to this man, calling himself powerful man in the community. Twinkling of an eye, it was like a movie. Some of us were monitoring the old thing, as young as we were. Something was happening. Wicked people cannot go like this forever. Proverbs 23, verse 17. Say,
let not your heart,
that is what it says, envy sinners. Please. But thou,
be thou in the fear
of the Lord all day long. Please, don't envy anyone.
especially the sinners that are doing well. They are doing well for their own destruction. It's going to be for a brief moment. And by the time you see their head, you will say, ah, God, I thank you. You didn't give me the word like that man or like that woman. Let not your heart, because the issue is the heart. Let not your heart ever say it. Asaph's heart was going wayward. What is going on now? Because of the prosperity of the wicked, he was very envious of them. But God has spoken, and his word cannot be broken. A bad end in judgment will soon come upon them. And that judgment is going to be very sudden, unexpected. It's going to be a complete. You see, don't think that those people can go scot-free on earth. Don't think that it's only on the day of judgment that they're going to get their reward. Most of them will be getting their rewards here before they go and face the eternal hellfire. Why are we envied there? Oh, that man is serving 100,000 per week. What is your business about that? Go and ask him what is he doing with 100,000 pounds per week. In fact, there are some people earning a lot of money and they're in debt. They have 100,000 per week and then they say they're in debt. You'll be wondering, how can someone earning 100,000 per week be in debt? Is that not a very serious question? But they're in debt! Because Satan has opened his mouth to get that 100,000 every week, and it won't be sufficient for them. So whatever God has given you, be content with that. Just be thanking God, and by the time you are thanking God, God will open his windows of heaven. I think you know that this year is the year of unrestricted possibilities for us, and that will be your portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Asaph seen that he had been very foolish. Verse 21. Thus my heart was grieved and I was breaking my reins. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee. You can imagine. Look at him and say, sorry, God. That aspect is for him to say, God, forgive me. I am very sorry. I have now seen their head. Why should I be envied the prosperity of the wicked? I am waiting for my own time, Lord. I'm waiting. I am waiting. Your time is coming. It's around the corner in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
People will know you for the glory of the Lord in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Please. That's what the Lord said I should tell you. Don't get depressed because of what is going on around you. He now gains a new view of God. Verses 23. Nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holding me by my right hand. He said, thou shalt guide me with thy counsel. The Lord will guide you with his counsel in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
He said, I know you will guide with your counsel. No matter the situation you are going through. Because he has been the one that took your hand in the past. He is the one that is guiding you at present. And in future, you will go into the glory of the Lord. That is the most important aspect. The Lord will take you into his glory at the end of your race on earth in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Therefore, say, God is my portion. Verse 26. My flesh and my heart failed. I was thinking like a foolish person. But God is the strength of my heart.
Can you tell your neighbor, God is the strength of my heart.
God is the strength of my heart.
Tell your other neighbor, God is the strength of my heart.
God is the strength of my heart.
I'm a portion forever.
I'm a portion forever.
I'm a portion forever.
I'm a portion forever.
Yes. So if we now see the difference between the wicked and the righteous, he has now decided to put everything before the Lord. If you know Christ, the best is yet to come to you. And before the end of this year, you will come and sing your song in the name of Jesus. Proverbs 3:33. The cause of the Lord is in the arms of the wicked. That is, God has caused the wicked. The cause of the Lord is in the house of the wicked. But he blesses the habitation of the just. The blessings of the Lord will overflow your lives in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Verse 27:28. For lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. That is the wicked. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a warring from thee. Say, but it is good for me to draw nigh to God. So that I put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all thy hands. Have you put your trust in the Lord? No comparison with envy. Anger with frustration, no. Because there's going to be sudden destruction to the wicked. The cling to God in times of confusion is going to guide you with a skillful hand to your land of blessings in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Through difficult times, we come. Put your trust, as I've said, put my trust in him. Please put your trust in him. Let him guide you and provide for your needs. Make him your rock, your firm foundation, and he will continue to lead you and will be surely good unto you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Shall we rest on our feet?